In this video, we will cover Heap Level 0 from exploitexercises.com protostar. It's the Heap Exploitation Introductories Challenge and is very easy. We again compile this on a Ubuntu 16.04 LTS version, so basically a modern system, to see if or how it's still exploitable. And spoiler alert, nothing changed for this challenge, it's super straightforward. But I have a special idea for this video, and even if it's a bit easy for you, you might want to check out what else we learn at the end. In the previous videos of this series, I usually create the exploit and then think of a way how to explain and show it to you. But this is so simple that I thought it would be cool if I would instead record myself solving it, kind of like a blind solve or a speedrun, but I didn't try to be super fast, but it was quite straightforward, and I include all the mistakes and pauses I made. And now we will step through the video and I explain to you what I have been thinking in different moments, and point out some other things. In the top right corner you can also see a timer that will keep track of how long it took me in real time. But before we start doing the exploit, let's have a look at the code again. There are two functions, winner and no winner, and obviously we have to somehow call winner. We can also see there are two structs that get space allocated for them on the heap. And this FP construct here looks complex, but you can ignore that weirdness because when you look in the code, it's clear what it does. We set FP to winner. Notice how no winner has no parentheses. This means it's not being called. This is literally the function pointer, and adding parentheses would cause a call. And then later we have those parentheses for FP, and FP has been set to point to no winner, so no winner is executed. And our goal is to somehow use the string copy, which will overflow the name buffer, which is only 64 byte large, and overwrite the function pointer. So, sounds easy. I start by opening up the binary in GDB and do a first test execution, but I run into a seg fault, which startled me for a few seconds. But then I realized I forgot the argument parameter again. The string copy uses the first argument to copy into name. Okay, now we had a clean execution. Now I want to set a breakpoint, so I disassemble main. I'm quickly scanning the assembler code here, mainly looking for the different function calls to figure out what corresponds to what in the C code. And at first I was thinking about setting a breakpoint before or after the string copy to catch the before and after of the overflow. But in the last moment then I figured that I probably don't need to look at this closely, and I can simply go to the magic position right away, the call RDX. This is calling the function pointer that contains no winner. Okay, so I execute it again and we hit the breakpoint. Now, this challenge is about a heap overflow, so I first check the virtual memory map of the process with vmmap. Here you can see in which memory regions we have the binary itself with the code and data segments, and we can also see where the stack is and where the shared libraries like libc are loaded to. And we also have the heap here. So obviously I want to check out how the heap looks like. Examine 32 64-bit hex values from the start of the heap. I immediately look for the name we entered as an argument, which was AAAA. So here they are. And I also immediately look for the function pointer. This looks like an address. Quick sanity check with the disassemble command. Here is a puts call using this address as a parameter, and that is our no winner string. So yep, that's no winner. So now we want to overwrite that with winner, so we need the address. Here it is. Next, I need to figure out how much we have to overflow to do that, and I simply look at the addresses to the left. Address of the start of the name ends in hex 10, and the function pointer is at hex 60, so we have an offset of hex 50. So now I'm feeling confident, and actually drop out of GDB and hope to have a working exploit right away. So I start by writing a short Python inline script to print the exploit string. Essentially, we need a couple of characters as padding to reach the function pointer, and so I print a few A's. Quick check again how many there was. Hex 60 minus hex 10, so we need hex 50. After that, we need the address of winner. So for 0, oops, I almost made a mistake. This still happens to me sometime. We obviously have to start with F6 05. and then 4.0 because of the endianness. Now for a sanity and debugging step, I pipe the output into hex dump to see if it is what I expect. But then I notice a hex 0a at the end, and that's a new line. Python print will add a new line at the end, which we don't want. So now I change the script to use the sys module instead in order to directly write a string to std out, so we don't have a new line. And I verify that again with hex dump. And then I'm basically done and I try it on the target binary. So the input is passed as an argument, so I use backticks to execute the inner Python command, and the output is then basically replaced by it and then placed here as the arguments. Level passed. Awesome. I executed the winner function. You see, this was super simple. So when I was writing the script with the commentary of my recording, I noticed a small detail that I didn't think about, and I actually never thought about it before. So here's the heap output again. Do you see this data down here? That is clearly ASCII, and that's weird. In our program, we did not allocate any string like this on the heap. So how did this happen? When you look at this ASCII text, then you will realize it's in fact the printf output. But why is that on the heap? Let's investigate. First, I thought we could check out Valgrind. Valgrind is an instrumentation framework for building dynamic analysis tools. They are Valgrind tools that can automatically detect many memory management and threading bugs and profile your program in detail. I really should use Valgrind more often. I use it way too little. But there's, for example, the Valgrind output with tracing malloc enabled. And then we run our heap 0 level. And we can indeed see here our two mallocs of the structs we do, but also a malloc we didn't do of 1024. That's also the only memory that is freed again. The mallocs we do have no free. So why is this happening? Another interesting output is strace. Strace traces syscalls. And while we don't see mallocs here, because malloc is just some algorithm and memory management implemented in libc, we can see the brk syscall, which gets the memory from the operating system in the first place. So this is where we get the memory that will then be used by libc for the heap. So if malloc is a libc function, we can also check out ltrace, which traces linked dynamic library function calls. But oddly enough, we only see two mallocs for the two structs. Nothing about the mysterious third malloc. It might not be immediately obvious, but this is actually already a really good hint that the mysterious malloc did not happen from a dynamically linked library call, which means this malloc must have been executed, for example, by libc itself, and Valgrind is a bit smarter and also traces these internal mallocs. For the third test, I create a simple program that calls puts, so it prints a string. Because we know the heap did contain the printf output, so it must have to do something with that. And then we can debug the program and set a breakpoint on brk. Remember, brk is a syscall that is called when a program requests additional virtual memory, and so this is called when the heap is set up. And the heap is not always set up, only if it is required. So if we assume printf or puts calls malloc, it would have to set up the heap first. Now, that's also why I created the small test program, because the original heap 0 has obviously regular mallocs before the printf, which makes it a bit annoying, so this is a clean example. On a second note, when you set a breakpoint with a symbol name like brk, there has to be the symbol name for it. And a syscall doesn't have a symbol name. A syscall is an assembler interrupt instruction with a number as parameter to indicate which syscall you want. But there is a brk symbol, but it's not initially found. You first have to execute the program in order to load the dynamic library libc, which does contain a brk symbol. And in fact, that is a regular function as a wrapper around the brk syscall. So anything inside of libc would not directly do the syscall interrupt, it would call the internal brk function, so that's why we can easily set a breakpoint like this. Long story short, we can now continue and hit that breakpoint and then examine the function backtrace, which tells us which functions have been called that led to this brk call. I cleaned it up a bit. So here we go. You can see it starts with IO puts. You can also look at the libc code for that stuff. I just pulled up some mirror of libc on GitHub and you can read the code there. The reason why the function is not called puts but IO puts, even though we only use puts when we call it, has to do with a lot of C macros in libc. I find it really difficult to read that code. For example, we know the next function has a symbol name IO new file xs put n, but that doesn't show up in the C code. But there is this similarly called IO s put n, which when you look that up leads to a macro that says it's actually IO xs put n, which itself is another macro that is jumped to with underscore underscore xs put n as a first argument, and jump to is obviously another macro, and it just keeps going like that. Feel free to do that on your own. But if we trust our trace, we can see that at some point it calls do alloc buffer, and there's also a comment saying allocate a buffer if needed. So this 1024 byte malloc has to do with the standard output buffer. A printf doesn't immediately result in a syscall write, but libc implements a lot of stuff like this in order to achieve higher performances by buffering output instead of waiting for files or writing a few bigger chunks instead of a lot of small pieces. Yeah, I would consider this a solved mystery. Just a little excursion into the inner workings of programs. I hope you liked it. See you next week.